Potholes and Penguins with Barry and Trimby.
Hello and you're very welcome to the weekly Pothole on Potholes and Penguins, and this week we have David Humphreys on the show. Trimby is definitely an idol of yours, and I pure loved him as well, despite him being neck and neck with Raj. What a player. He was so skillful and such a breath of fresh air to Irish rugby. Can't wait to talk to him. It's coming up in a few minutes, but before that, Maradona passed away, lads.
Just now, I got the notification before he came in the door.
Yeah.
60 years of age, boy.
Yeah. Massive heart attack.
Is that what happened?
Very sad, yeah.
Was he still coaching?
I don't know, actually, what he was at. He lived a pretty large life, to be fair to him. I'd say did well to get to 60. But what a player. Yeah. Some lunatic. What a story. And we were only talking about him last week, sure. And afterwards, someone got on to me saying that I should check out his documentary on Sky, I think. So I haven't seen it. Have you?
Oh, I saw that. I saw that in the cinema, that documentary.
Well,
brilliant. Yeah, it's class. Yeah, it's incredible, yeah.
I think I'll watch it tonight. And, of course, Krzysztof Dominici passed away yesterday.
Holy, man, I wish there was a documentary on Dominici. I would watch that. That would be incredible.
Did you play against
him? So sad. Yeah, I think I did. He, to me, I don't so much remember him, but I remember everything that he represented. You know, he was the exact representation of that kind of Stade Francais, that French flair. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he was the perfect guy. Like, he just encapsulates that. Mm-hmm. He's the reason why we all have this soft spot for French rugby, because we remember the way it was played by fellas like him. So, very sad.
Oh, so sad. I mean, yeah, the video's gone around of him scoring those tries the last few days. Yeah, it's a nice memory to have. But there's been a serious outpouring of sorrow across the rugby world, because he did sound like he was a bit of a legend. Very sad.
Yeah.
What else has gone on? My week has been
careful. You were stressed. You were stressed with the kids.
I had an interesting day yesterday. I had the twins on my own, and I have never brought them to Dunn's before, but I had to do a weekly shop.
Dunn's, your old hallowed stomping ground of walking in around the place.
This is it. It was like bringing them to Thomond Park.
I love
Dunn's.
I love this now. Don't ruin it for me.
Yeah, Dunn's. It was my day, my thing during the week. Go down to Dunn's and stroll around.
Dunn's is the Thomond Park in times of COVID, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Daddy, can we go to Dunn's?
And down there telling them about all the days that I spent in this Dunn's back in the day. See that cheese over there? I got it over that cheese one day.
One day, Peter Stringer threw me a whole lump of haddock out of the back of the freezer, and I caught it and I threw it into my trolley and I rammed it up the aisle there and went through the self-check-in, and everyone clapped as I went out the door and I was knocked unconscious.
Exactly. So I was excited yesterday morning. I got them up. I got them ready. It was windy and wet, so I had to put them into their jackets. I didn't put them into too many jackets because I thought they might roast in the car, which apparently happens. So I had them in light enough jackets to get them from the car park to the trolley, and then the trolley into Dunn's. And assuming that I'd seen this on somewhere where you can get a trolley that has the double. And I thought every trolley had this thing where you can put twins or two small children at the front of it and wheel them in. So I got the two of them out of the car and went over to the trolley, and no, that's not at every trolley station.
Yeah, you put your favorite twin in and then you buck the least favorite one in the main bit of the trolley, and hopefully they don't damage themselves.
See, I was thinking of that, so I can't. Annabelle wouldn't be able for that, for being in the middle and on her own. She'd hurt herself. She doesn't have the balance. And then Mick, I just don't trust him. He'd be throwing out everything. Everything I put in would be being flipped back out. So I said, right, I have to find one of these trolleys that has the double one. So then I carried Annabelle and I had the bags, and I was trying to hold Mick's hand, but he's so bold that he's pulling at me. So then I just got him by the sleeve, and then he pulls his hand out of the sleeve. So now I've just got the sleeve of his. So I've got him kind of like a lead, like a dog, that I'm just pulling him along. And his other hand is free and he's hitting me. And it's just people looking at me going, what is, whose children has this guy, is this guy after stealing? Because it couldn't be his. Then I got them in. I found a trolley that has the two seats, actual seats, baby seats at the front. And I whacked them into that. But see, I thought they'd be in like the seat that you flap down where they can move around and they're sitting up. But these were two seats like a car seat. So they were sitting back almost like they were lying down. And the second I put Mick into it, he was there. I could see in his face like, nah, this is not going to work for me. So I got him in the door of Dunn's and he just started screeching. He's developed this screech. And then he's trying to turn sideways to get out, and they're very crappy flimsy things to hold him in, so I had to hold him by the leg, and he was hanging out the side of the trolley for the whole time I was there, and I was just holding him by the leg, sweat, and with the mask, you know how much harder the mask makes it now. So I'm trying to put the oral is giving me a list as long as my arm then on my phone that I'm trying to look at. And Annabelle's screaming and he's screaming and the whole place is looking at me. And
where was Orla? Where were the twins' mother?
Exactly. Out at work.
Where was the twins' mother?
Out at work.
He was at the spa.
Yeah. She's the bread earner. This is these new times, lads. This is what my mother and your mother had been going through for years with feckin' four of us in the trolley. So
dad's down at the rugby club.
Yeah, doing nothing. I feel for them. I know the pain too well. So I get to the checkout, right? And I've got a trolley full now. I did a full week's shopping. Wallet was in the car. No wallet.
Oh, no.
Believe that, yeah.
So what'd you do?
I stood there for a minute and just was thinking of just pulling a legger, but then I knew we'd no food, so I'd be killed.
How far had you got? Had they checked the money?
I was at it.
So we're queuing up,
and it was my turn, which took ages as well to get there. And they were done now. They wanted to leave, so then I went over to this girl who's at the quick check-in, and I said to her, "I'm about to forget my wallet. Can you mind? What'll I do?"
And she was like, random woman, like
woman working there. And she was like, "You know, well, love, right." And I was like, "Can I take the trolley out and get my wallet?" She was like, "You can't leave with the shopping, but no paying for it." I was like, "Will you keep an eye on the children?" And then, and she looked at, we both looked at Mick, and he was just looking at her. And I was like, but you have to hold him by the leg or else he'll fall out. She was there. No, I'm not minding them. So I was like, remind her, if I take him with me, will you mind her? And she said, yeah, I'll mind her. So I ran out with him under my arm and get my wallet, which was way back by the trolley thing. And then, because it's very hard, you have to park in a place that's open, because you have to get them out both sides, which is quite tricky. So I always have to park quite far away. And then I got back, and when I could hear Annabelle screaming from the door of Dunn's, and I got in, and the whole place is just looking at me. Both of them didn't stop screaming for the whole time I got the shopping paid for, and that was a nightmare.
Wow.
Then I got home yesterday, and I put them into the house, and I went out to get the shopping, and I thought I'd left the keys in the door, but I hadn't. So I'd locked them into the house, and I'd not get in.
What?
Yeah. Have you ever done that to me?
Lock the kids in the house by themselves? No. I haven't done that.
I thought it'd be standard enough, yeah. So I jumped the wall to see if the back door was open. Wasn't. Checked out every flower pot. Do you know the way you put the key under the most obvious place in the world sometimes? But there wasn't. But
you didn't try. You didn't try and explain to Annabelle.
No.
If you just go into the kitchen, get a chair, bring the chair to the front door. I know you're only walking.
Yeah. They climb up on top of each other's shoulders and open the door like the Great Escape. No, I think my mother told me, I told her the story. My mother said this happened to her when we were kids, and my brother got a hammer and smashed the window because he knew, he was old enough to know that they were locked out, and he was like, I'm taking full advantage of this, and put a hammer through the window. Thankfully my neighbor had a key buried somewhere, and got it. It took 10 minutes and there was a delivery guy arrived in the middle of it with a big box and for Aura. And
big box of crows to put back in the chimney.
I was outside going, sorry, I'm locked out. All right. And I was like, and my kids are inside. He was like, Jesus Christ, man.
You must have been heaving sweat now at this point after all the carry on.
Yeah, it was a mess. Ruined my day. And you were texting me in the middle of it looking for things and I was just quit. Yeah, so that was my first trip to Dunn's with the twins. Great crack.
And we were like pestering you, Barry, if you wouldn't mind getting back to that penguin in the Facebook group.
Yeah.
Where's the jumpers? Where's the socks? Has anyone seen the website? I'm after losing my keys.
We've great take up on the merchandise, actually.
They love it, don't they?
They love it, yeah. The sexy socks and the hats.
Risky Business was the movie you were recording.
Yeah. Good one, isn't it? And the bum bag.
I did know it. Yeah, the bum bag.
I'm going to get the bum bag. It's a Champion bum bag. It's actually really good quality, as are the rest of them. But yeah, we'll be head to toe in it soon enough.
We're head to toe in our hunting gear because we're going fighting monsters.
Don't me and Dermy look like we're going catching some sort of a swamp monster or something like that? I'll catch our monster. We're both wearing army outfits. Like two neck things.
FCA.
Like going duck hunting or something.
Yeah, you two look like you're going out hunting. I look like I'm going to Sunday school.
Are you making your confirmation?
How was your few days, Andrew?
Good. This is how dull life is at the minute, actually. I was excited about going to Glasgow and doing the first non-Ulster game I've done, actually. But that's not the dull bit. That's the fun bit. The dull bit is then just sitting around Edinburgh all day, just waiting for a flight, doing nothing, hotel room. But I was going, this is brilliant. Way better than Barry's day anyway. Way less stressful. But I took a notion. I got, flight was about 1 o'clock and kickoff on Monday night in Glasgow was 8 o'clock. We weren't meeting till 5. So I had about 3 hours to kill and Glasgow's completely locked down. Nothing's open at the minute. So it was a ghost town. And I just took a notion as I was at the airport. I was going, well, what am I going to do? If I get to the stadium, it might not be open. There's nothing to do nearby. I can't get into a coffee shop. And so I decided to walk from the airport into Glasgow. Whoa. And it seemed like a sensible thing to do at the time because it was because I had to kill time. And then I only realized how weird it was whenever I stupidly let on to the other pundits, Chris Patterson and Al Kellogg. And you know, whenever you're meeting people and it's kind of a professional setup, and I was just keen to give a good first impression, like a professional impression. And they thought I was this, like, that was the weirdest thing they've ever heard. We walked from the airport to Scotstoun Stadium. And then now I think about it, it was a weird thing to do.
How long did it take you?
Took me just over 2 hours.
And it's a trip in from an airport is never a scenic route. Like you're
not pleasant, and it rained the whole time.
Glasgow airport's a bit outside, like, as well, isn't
it? So I walked all the way along the fence, like, that lines the kind of runway, and then walked through this little village, like a walked through this real rough estate with all these, like, real rough Glasgow kids playing football on the front grass with using their bikes as goalposts, you know. Walked through there and then ended up in this wee wee path, like, people go to walk their dogs, really secluded. I don't know where Google Maps was taking me. Managed to get through that and ended up in this kind of industrial estate. Walked through that and then got to the, like, down by the river, and I thought, I just assumed Google Maps was going to take me across a bridge, like, call me naive, right? But we just saw, like, a dotted blue line, you know, the walk route. And I got there and I was like, there's no bridge here. And it was really secluded, really dark, and it looked like a really low budget horror movie. And
there's a little places to die.
Yeah. And there was a little jetty or like a wee slipway, And there was like a wee bus stop at the top of the slipway, and there was a wee homeless man sitting in the bus stop. So I just sat in next to him and tried. I was like, what's the story here? And it turned out there was a wee ferry. The ferry was the size of this room, tiny little ferry, and it just like lowered down like a wee drawbridge, like a wee corrugated iron drawbridge. And I just went up £2 and it took me across the river.
You got a magical mystery ferry across a river in Glasgow.
It was weird. And then I got to this little part of town called Yoker. And I love Lemmy, you know, the Glasgow comedian.
Me too. I love that one where he goes to Yoker and he goes into the barbershop and everything.
Yes. And I pitched my first step onto Yoker soil. I was in Yoker. I thought this day would never come. Is it really this easy? Is it really this easy to get the things you want in life? You just need to hold out for it. Oh yeah, sudden I had the urge to just go, here, I'm no fair Yoker, I've got no business being here. I was like, calm it, Dee Dee. That's no laughing matter, they tear you to shreds. Now you got 5 minutes. Where'd you want to go?
Yes. So I was like, Yoker, brilliant. I love Lemmy. It's bound to be great. It wasn't great. And then Dermy, you'll probably get this as well. There's a coffee shop called Dee Dee's Cafe.
Yeah.
Dee Dee, the character from Lemmy. Yeah. I was like, no, that brightened up what was a really dull 2 hours walking, I must say, seeing that coffee shop. And then it was like kind of, it was fine from then on. But I, as I arrived at the stadium, I thought, what I just did is weird. Don't tell the lads. And then just whenever I met them, then they just went, well, how are you? How are you? How was today? How was the journey across? And then I just stupidly sputtered out, walked from the airport, and they all just went, you're a weirdo. That's the weirdest thing everybody's ever done. So
what an experience, though. I like that you're that weird. You could have just gotten a taxi and sat in the cafe and done the usual stuff. But now here we are and you're talking about it.
And you were in Yoker.
You were in Yoker and you were on a boat.
You're in a magical mystery ferry.
did the young fellas slag you or anything?
Oh yeah, they slagged me, especially because they were anticipating, because it was a stinking night. It wasn't a great game. They were anticipating there was going to be no rugby played, and they were like,
the young fellas that you walked past.
No, they didn't. Nah, I had my headphones in because they probably were abusing me actually, but I had my headphones in. I was just playing dumb. But
I was hoping they would. I saw a tweet the other day, and there was a lad who said it was going into Dunn's and there were teenagers outside, and one of them pointed at me and said, "There's you, tis me," and then they all started roaring laughing.
That's a great slag.
There's you.
They own you. They absolutely own you, those young fellas, because there's safety in numbers. No matter what they say, their mates are going to laugh and you're going to be in the receiving end of it.
Yeah.
It's. I think it's the funniest tweet I've ever read. Fuck, I laughed so much. Anyway, you went to the rugby then. And was the rugby any better? It was a good game, actually, wasn't it?
I really enjoyed it. And those lads are great. Al Kelly, great lad. I got a lot of texts from people wondering what he was saying. But anyway, he's great. Chris Patterson, great. Good fellas, actually. And I really enjoyed it. First time, it was a little bit out of my comfort zone because obviously commentating in Ulster's, no, it's not easy, but it's easier because I know all the players, but there was one or two. I had to do a bit more homework for this one.
It was
the game itself.
Good game. I think you added your usual little quirkiness, which people appreciate. Silly little gags.
Some people appreciate.
No,
not all.
It's perfect for a Monday night. You're sitting in, you're fucking watching a good game of rugby. You want it to be lighthearted. Can't be that serious. Fucking Monday night, we've all got things to do. Sit down and listen to someone having a bit of crack, watching the match. So I really enjoyed it. And a good game. Ben Healy and Craig Casey again, shining for Munster.
Yeah, they were both going great. When they were warming up, we were doing our bit on the end of the pitch in the temporary stand, and Ben Healy was like doing a bit of kicking in around the goal line, and he turned around and we were just, there's nowhere else to look. Like, you just look towards the pitch. I'm not looking at you in particular, Ben, but I was looking that direction, and we caught eyes, and I just had this moment. I was like, does he know that I've been slagging him? And it really,
100%.
But like in a nice way. Like that's exactly. A nice slag to say that he looks like the drug dealer from Pulp Fiction.
Exactly. And well, you didn't like his hair. I thought it looked well in the rain.
It needs rain. It does. It needs rain.
It's too much volume.
But yeah, halfbacks both went brilliantly. Mike Healy went really well. Gavin Coombs was brilliant again. He's going to be great for you lads.
Yeah, solid. Scoring tries for fun. Two man of the match performances. Getting a bit of tussle with Ryan Wilson, who wouldn't shake his hand. It was a brilliant win. They were buzzed up about it. And do you know what? All across the board for the Irish provinces this weekend last weekend in the Pro 14, four bonus point wins. Leinster hammered Cardiff. Cardiff were piss poor. But another brilliant one from Leinster. Ulster had a great win against Scarlets, didn't they?
They nearly got their pants pulled down.
Still get knocking out wins though.
Yeah, and it's another bonus point, to be fair. Five bonus points and seven wins from seven. So Ulster going great, but I thought Scarlets probably let that one slip a little bit. Scarlets were good. They played really well, to be fair.
Yeah, scored some nice tries.
Yeah.
Connacht as well had a brilliant win over Zebra. And a few of our favourite players, Jack Carty looking schlick, and Little Sprout came on, had a nice little chip. Good to see him back. We haven't seen much of him, have we?
Sorry, Sprout and Turnip. Which one's which again?
Sprout is the younger.
Okay.
He's the Sprouter of the Turnip. Do you remember Turnip is the older brother that looks like a turnip?
The older brother's Connor? No.
Stephen. Stephen is the older brother. He's the Turnip. Connor is the younger brother. He's the Sprout. Yep.
Sorted. There you go. Filed away.
Analysis done on Connacht. Tick. but yeah, great win. Ireland, Georgia, about to get into with David Humphreys. Looks like Stuart McCluskey's going to start. Those of you listening to this in the future, congratulations, you know this. But I'm delighted because he was doing a press conference today. I said to you last week that he would probably start. You were like, he doesn't want to start. But now he is. What do you think?
If that's the way it came across, didn't mean it to sound like that. I'm not saying he doesn't want to start. I'm just saying he's bound to be disheartened, I suppose, because he just never got a chance against Tier 1. And actually, he said one thing in one article I read. He looks back on his first game against England at Twickenham and wishes he'd maybe just took advantage of that more, or maybe just, I don't know, maybe took more risks, or I don't know, just expressed himself a little bit more. But you know, you get that one chance, and I was actually rooming with Stu that time, and to be fair, we got spanked, so it was difficult. But yeah, he deserves opportunities, and he deserves to get opportunities against Tier 1, you know, in the Six Nations or something, because he's definitely good enough. And it's just really gotten from his perspective that there's so much competition in there.
Okay, well look, let's get David Humphreys' perspective on it as well, as we have him on for the weekly Pothole coming right up.
Okay, this week, our weekly Pothole is David Humphreys, as in we are the Potholes, Humph. We're potholing you. welcome along. Great to have you on the show, Humph.
Nice to talk to you again,
Humph, you were a hero of mine growing up. I had a picture of you on my wall.
Trevor, you're much nicer to me than you usually are. So
You'll get there.
There's two types of kids growing up playing rugby in Ireland. One kid like me has pictures of Humph on their wall. Another kid like Barry has pictures of Pamela Anderson on his wall. You thought I was going to say O'Gara, didn't you? You were expecting O'Gara.
He might have been there as well.
Yeah, both. Did you, Humph, do you remember the first time we played together? Barry was actually there. This is the great reunion, the three of us. Do you remember this, Humph?
The one in Enniskillen.
Yeah.
We gave away a try in the first minute, and Johnny Bell and I looked at each other, Trimby, and said, "Wait, this guy's meant to be a good player. What's happened?"
Hey. He didn't give away the try.
It all could have ended right there.
His opposite number tore him to shreds at that moment, and it was nothing he could do about the try. That's the way I remember it, right?
I remember him coming across the front of Johnny Bell and myself to make a tackle when the ball was 25 yards away. So that was our first introduction to what we thought was going to be the next superstar.
Oh, what a disappointment. I hadn't a clue what I was doing. And just whenever I needed you and Dinger to take me aside and say, you know, it's all right. It's all right, Trimby. Don't worry. You'll get the hang of this. You just looked at me as if like this guy has no future with Ulster Rugby. He's going nowhere.
Long time ago.
Yeah.
It was a fall from grace for the 2E to be playing in an A match in a skill. And I'd say at that point in your careers, how did you end up there?
Do you know what? I actually don't know the answer to that. Trimby, can you remember? What was the game for? It was to open a new pitch.
Yeah.
But I actually don't remember anything about it except for the fact that Trimby gave away that try. We did win in the end, I think.
We got there in the end.
We were preparing for an under-21s World Cup, I think. So it was giving us a game before the World Cup and opening the pitch as well. So that was my memory of it. I don't remember you winning, but I'll give it to you. I'll give you that one.
So you were getting ready for World Cup at the time, Humph? And you hadn't played
it's terrible. I have a dreadful memory for games that I've played in. And, I remember very little about it except that we were opening a new pitch.
Yeah. Yeah. So those are the big moments at Enniskillen.
Your road to stardom. Who would have thought you've ended up being a radio presenter or whatever the.
whatever it is now. Whatever you young fellas call it, you radio presenters or something. but Humph, listen, let's catch up quickly then. How are you enjoying being back in the team environment then with Georgia?
Yes, it's been very enjoyable. It's actually been a fascinating insight into Tier 2 rugby. You and I spoke last week. Coming into a competition like this, when you come into an international team, and with the level of competition, I probably had a slightly different expectation of what it might be like. And as I said, the one word I've used a number of times is fascinating, to see the gap between what Tier 2 nations do in preparation versus what you guys would have been used to with Ireland and the way that England and Ireland and anybody else really prepare for this competition. So it's been fascinating, but hugely enjoyable. You see very different qualities in the players here, and from an expectation point of view, you don't really appreciate how these young Georgian players hold some of the players they're playing against. They all that a bit like you were saying earlier, Trimby, about some of the players that you played against earlier and grew up with. That's why it's been a real shock to their system, I think.
Yeah, and what about yourself then? Are you Is it nice to get back in that team environment and back in the crack, back in kind of match day and get the kind of the team nerves again? Is that something you've missed since you've moved away from Gloucester?
No, do you know what? I haven't missed it at all. If I'm honest, I have that. That's the bit that, I haven't missed that. I've really enjoyed being able to watch rugby as a rugby fan and as a supporter without that real, grim sense of, sometimes despair with the result determining everything about the game. So I've really enjoyed watching rugby again. And, coming in here, my role is very much a short-term role. It's coming in, observing, helping the head coach prepare for the games, just the preparation around the team in terms of how we structure the week, looking at the game plan and different things. So it's not like it is in a club environment, but it's still been very enjoyable, been able to, have those conversations with players, with the coaches, and get an understanding of what people from a very different background and culture expect from rugby.
Have you spent much time over in Georgia? Is that are you based there now? Did you move over before the competition?
No, not at all, Barry. It all happened very quickly with Japan dropping out of the Autumn Nations Cup due to COVID, and this opportunity for Georgia arose. And they, as you will both know, there's been lots of media speculation. They're very ambitious in terms of where they would like Georgia to go. Because at the minute, the big difficulty they have is that when they're playing the European Nations Cup, they beat teams as easily as England beat them. So they're very much in this middle ground where their current opposition isn't good enough. Most of the tier one teams are too good. So it's trying to find where their level is in order to allow them to get better, to get their players better, so that at some stage in the future, rather than just every 4 years in a Rugby World Cup cycle where they're preparing for, they're having a decent quality competition year on year.
Yeah, so is it like kind of the bottom of tier one, the top of tier two, almost like somewhere in between Japan and Italy is kind of the sort of teams that they should be playing or would be competing with or you'd see a good game with?
Yeah, and that's my view, Trimby, that's with who they want to be playing against. They want to be playing against those teams where those teams are probably slightly better than they are. But over time, playing at that level regularly, if they can win one or two, it'll give them the confidence that when they come into a World Cup or a higher level competition, they do have that little bit of belief that they can compete and they can, you know, they can win games. Because ultimately, in all sport, you're there to win. And, you know, it's hard for them. The last couple of weeks have been disappointing for at a whole lot of different levels. But it's more a case, not just in the results, but it's been more a case of trying to show an improvement from week one, which was against Scotland, through these four games. And I've answered Barry's question in a long-winded way. I've never been to Georgia.
How's your Georgian?
Terrible. have you ever listened to Georgian? I speak fast, but I think compared to most of the way the Georgians speak, I'm actually quite slow, so that gives you a sense of the language. They say, talking about it to someone else, and they say that Georgian is the fourth hardest language in the world to learn, so I dread to think what the first three are.
Yeah, I was, that's why I was in touch with you last week, because I needed some sort of insight into Georgian rugby, and not being a scholar of Georgian rugby myself. Even just learning how to pronounce the names correctly would have been enough for me feel like I was doing something.
Yeah, that's a sort of a slight aside in itself, in that Dopey and I, every player here has got a very short nickname, so that's why we've been saved. They're struggle to pronounce their names as it is, but thankfully we know them all now by very, very easy nicknames.
And how's Dookie settling in? Because Dookie can be impatient enough at times when he's trying to deliver something and it's not being received well.
Do you know what? He has been absolutely brilliant. And I think very much one of the things that when we sat down to look forward into the competition and preview the competition, the brief was very much that Georgian rugby historically has been about set piece. It's been about physical defence. It's about big men with who defend well, but they have got this ambition to develop their attacking game. Unfortunately, the basics of the game haven't really been good over the last 3 weeks, but again, because of the gulf between Tier 1 and Tier 2, it has made building an attack quite difficult. But from an organisation and a structural point of view and a game understanding point of view among their halfbacks and other backs, and listen, their whole team, they've got a much better idea of what we are aspiring to do attacking-wise. The set piece and the weather have been difficult, but hopefully going into the Irish game, we'll be able to show a little bit more attacking flair than we have over the last two games. And if we're able to do that, Doki has run the whole attacking programme.
Yeah, but yeah, as you said there, it does look like there's been green shoots. It does look like towards the end of the Wales game, one or two little offloads were starting to stick, and as you say, conditions weren't great. And actually, it was in the balance that game for long periods up until what, 70 minutes, whenever they got that last score. So it does look like whatever Dougie's doing is starting to, you're starting to see some sort of outcome there.
No question. But as we all know, anybody involved in rugby knows the defence is pretty easy to get set, to get organised. Set piece, hopefully again this week will be a lot better. But attack takes the longest to get a really, especially when you're trying to change a mindset more than anything else. So, you know, we're very conscious that it's not something that's going to be solved in the short term, but hopefully over time, with the work that they've done in this month, as they then prepare for the next competition in the springtime, that, as you said, there are some good foundations there that will allow them to build on that going forward.
Exciting then, going into Sunday, playing Ireland in the Aviva. That must be class for you. Are you here already? Are you in Ireland now?
No, we're still in London. We, the way the bubble has worked here, we have flown into each, in Wales we drove, took a coach, but basically we fly into Dublin on Friday afternoon and then fly back out on Sunday back to London. So, you know, that's one of the things that the, with the implications of COVID and the limitations that has had on the players, been confined really to a hotel for the last 3 weeks now. It's tough for the players. It's but they've dealt with it fantastically well, and hopefully they'll enjoy their trip to Dublin. Yeah.
How will you be prepping them to play in Lansdowne Road? Obviously, you've been there, done that. It must be great to get back there, first of all, is it?
We all know what a wonderful place it is to play rugby. It's going to be slightly surreal this weekend with no crowd in. Nearly all my best memories of playing rugby, whether that was for Ulster, for Ireland, have all been at Lansdowne Road, the Aviva. And a lot of these players who haven't played or have prior to this competition haven't experienced performing in these wonderful stadiums around Europe, this is another opportunity for them to play in a great place. And in terms of preparation, Barry, the big thing for us has been, we can't worry about Ireland, we couldn't worry about Wales, we couldn't worry about Scotland, because you wouldn't want to go and play. That's how good those teams are. So really our focus throughout this competition has been making sure we can get our team in the best possible place to prepare for Sunday.
Mm. Yeah, so the Aviva, you mentioned the Aviva there and Lansdowne Road. I remember actually back in the day, whenever myself and Tommy got into the squad initially, you took us under your wing a little bit. And I remember you had a new BMW at the time and you were kind of showing off, driving it around. But I remember you gave me...
You're making up stories now. This is what I expected when I agreed to come on to this, Paul. That you had...
We've gotten all the rugby stuff out of the way now.
Yeah. You mean the radio show? Come on, for these two radio DJs.
Podcast, I used to...
So I just remember there was... you took me and Tommy out quite a bit and looked after us. And there was one piece of advice you gave me. And actually, it always stuck with me because I was getting my first game at the weekend, that weekend against Australia. And you said, Trimby, just take a moment at some stage during the game, look around and just drink it in and enjoy it. And I always tried never to let an opportunity, like a big moment like that, to pass me by. And looking back now, I'm so glad that someone like you gave me that advice, just to kind of savor it and enjoy it. So that stuck with me. But yeah, I just remember you just driving us up and down the lane at City West and your BM, like revving the car. And
didn't Rod used to slag you about that, didn't he? Didn't Rod used to slag you about going out in the car with Daddy or something like that, didn't he?
Yeah, yes, he said. He goes in the team room one day, he goes, "Where's Daddy taking the two kids today?"
It wouldn't be like Rod, would it? But sometimes people forget, and it doesn't even matter at international level. It's that when you're fortunate enough to play in those big games, they pass by so quickly. People who, until you're out there, you don't realize first whistle goes and then the final whistle goes. And, you work so hard to get to that point in time. You've got to be able to try and enjoy it. There are moments where you wish you were anywhere else. Mm. But at certain points in the game, you've got to look around and go, this is what it's all about. This is why I have sacrificed so much in terms of getting to this point. And, I still maintain that, Trimby, today, even to all, to my son, to everybody else, no matter what you're doing, take a moment to enjoy it.
I remember one of my favorite memories in the Aviva was as a supporter in Lansdowne Road in 2001, I'd say, the All Blacks game where, I'd say that was the closest we'd look like coming in my lifetime beating the All Blacks. And I was in the schoolboy terrace. Not a schoolboy, but drinking cans in the schoolboy terrace. And the atmosphere, I'll never forget it. We were winning after 50, 55 minutes maybe. I think you'd scored a drop goal and you'd probably had one of the best games I'd ever seen you play. And they came back and snatched it or kind of won in the last 15 minutes. But what are your memories of that game? Was that the one time you feel like you maybe could have beaten the All Blacks?
Unquestionably, again, talking about highlights, that game would go down as one of my most enjoyable games, really, from the moment facing the Haka And when Brian O'Driscoll scored just after half time, I think we all probably felt, do you know what, this might be the moment. And then I think Jonah Lomu scored a couple of tries. He ran over me 2 or 3 times, which is no major achievement. But I just remember he came back. We'd seen a play all week that he had worked on, which was a 2-5, the centre going across, bringing him back into my channel. And we'd worked all week, and Kevin Maggs staying to tackle him because I just wasn't going to tackle him. in the game, it's happening in front of us from exactly the play. Maggsy's gone. So I just remember Lomu running over the top of me as I'm lying in the ground. He runs over the top of Gervin Dempsey, scores under the posts, and that was... But there was a moment in that game which I vividly recall where shooting out of line, I had a chance to intercept the ball when we were leading, and I dropped it because I thought it was offside. That was probably the turning point of the game in terms of, well, not a turning point, but it was a key moment in the game. And but as you said, Barry, to play the All Blacks, to face the Haka, that was one of those moments that we talked about, Trimby, where you look around and go, I actually can't believe I'm here.
The atmosphere, I think, when you look back to those games especially, there was no phones, there's way more people in the stadium than there should have been, and there was an excitement around Irish rugby because of the way you were playing, the way Woody was playing, the way you were playing, the way Draco was playing, and there was a sense of belief that there was a change. And for me as a young fella in school, coming out of school, and I think that era really gave a big I don't know, it created a serious buzz in rugby in Ireland, the excitement of how you were playing. And you know, yourself, when I look back at you then, watching you today, your clips back, the level of skill that you had in terms of your spiral kicking, your passing, your
shot. I'm being nice.
You're teeing you up. Don't trust him.
No, but it was never seen before, really, what that level of skill. We'd had some brilliant out halves, obviously, before you, with Eric Elwood and even back in the 80s. The level that you had across the board, I mean, how do you feel like now as a director of rugby and looking at young lads and developing their skills, how did you feel you managed to kind of, I suppose, develop across the board as a 10 those kind of skills?
James, that's a pretty deep question. What I would say is that I actually consider myself very, very lucky to have played in the amateur game as well as the professional game. And what's different now, but I didn't lift a weight until I was 25 years old. So until we were fitness tested, I think about just after the 1995 World Cup was the first time I was fitness tested. And I've still got the scores from those tests. And my max bench press was 60 kilos. So that I genuinely had never been in the gym.
That was twice your body weight though at the time.
That's probably true as well. But in those days, we were playing 3 games a week at university. That we played a Saturday, we played a Dudley Cup game for Queens on a Wednesday, we played on a Saturday. So it was all about playing rugby. It was not about individual skills. And I just honestly believe that one of the big challenges that we're facing in the game now is that we've got these fantastic athletes coming through at every level in every country. But for me to develop the skills and the game understanding, you need to be playing at a young age 20, 25 games a year, especially in those decision-making positions through the spine of the team. And, you know, we're judging players who haven't had that. We're judging players. We throw them in for one game, whether it's at club level, international level, and say, oh, he's not good enough. Well, players need time to develop all that understanding. So it's something that I feel very strongly about. And now we've got a balance between player welfare, too many games versus not enough games. And I don't know what the solution is, but it's something that we're all really, really in the game understand that has to be addressed.
Yeah, because if you play, I suppose there's so much physicality and the training load and the physical load asked of some of these young fellas before they've even physically kind of matured. They're 18, 19, 20. And if they're asked to play 25 games a year, I suppose it was different back then because there weren't the same collisions, but because there's that many collisions, then you're going, well, you can't get the experience without getting your head kicked in, and it's really hard to get the balance.
That's where the dilemma lies, Trimby, but we have to find a way of getting them, and whether that's at a, you know, say that your 9s and your 10s just playing rugby at a lower level, the game is easy on a computer screen. There's lots of experts who can say, oh, look at that space, he should have made that decision. We all know that if I'm catching the ball slightly on a wet day, it's not caught quite properly, somebody's about to take my head off. It doesn't matter where the space is. You're then into not a survival mode, but the ability to beat somebody, the ability then to play the next phase. So we're so obsessed with trying to find a theoretical answer to it. There is no theory. You got to get players on the pitch. And it's a big challenge for everybody in the game.
Is that the role you see yourself kind of staying in now? You've done the director of rugby, which in Gloucester, which I presume was something similar, putting structures in place, and now what your role now. Is that somewhere where you see yourself in the future? Like you seem to be quite passionate about it and trying to, right those wrongs, which I know they're not anyone's actual fault, but yeah. It is pretty clear that maybe is where the gap is at the moment. Is that something that you see your future in?
I would love to be involved in that sort of thing, Barry. I've had a wonderful, I think it's now 12 years in that sort of operations director of rugby role with the team. I would love to explore something different. What that looks like, I don't know. It's obviously in the middle of the worst recession, COVID recession. It's a difficult time to be looking for any particular role. So at the minute, I don't know where the next step is, but... It's an interesting.
I saw Leicester when Jordan Murphy stepped aside a couple of weeks ago. Leicester have announced that they're not fulfilling the director rugby role. They've now said their, can you remember what it's called, the strategic vision and off field responsibility. They're now changing the role to, and that kind of for me looked like it was something down those lines where it was looking at the whole structure of a club and the grassroots. Coming through to, you know, not just worrying about that senior team and getting 15 players in the pitch. It's about who's going to be the 15 players in the pitch 5 or 6 years down the road. Is that something you'd agree with?
I think a lot of clubs have moved in that direction before the impact of COVID and the impact in budgets. I think lots of teams understood that because it's certainly in England, in the Premiership, everybody was pretty much spending to the salary cap. So the only way that you could really strengthen your squad going forward was ensuring that the players coming through your academy system were good enough more quickly than in the past to step into that senior squad. With the impact of COVID, it's right across the sporting world, really. It's about survival. It's about trimming where you need to trim. But there's no doubt in my mind that rugby is still in its infancy in terms of professional sport compared to football. And when you see football going down this director of sport or director of football model, for those reasons that you've discussed, I do think rugby will follow suit because it's not like it was. Squads aren't just 25, 30 players. There's not 4 or 5 staff. In Gloucester, on an average day, we'd have about 100 people on site, and players and staff, including the academy. So it's now a big organisation that you need to take the pressure off someone who's also focusing on the short-term results. With a slightly longer-term strategic view. So, look, I think at the minute, decisions are made on budgets. Some teams will go that route, other teams will not.
Yeah, I mean, it'd be... The second I start thinking about that and I think about the All-Ireland League and how many players were produced from the All-Ireland League, you know, and the teams you played in and you know, the great European Cup winning team and the great European Cup winning team of Munster and even Leinster to a certain degree that first year. And then that kind of connection is gone now in Ireland. You know, a lot of, you know, you rarely see those players playing AIL and earning their crust. It generally kind of goes through the schools. So when I hear that conversation being had, it just excites me that maybe that connection would be made with underage teams in each province, with Munster and Ulster and Leinster and Connacht. So I don't know, that's exciting for me, but that's gone heavy, haven't we, Trimby? Jesus, we've gone.
Yeah, we got heavy. But you're enjoying what you're doing at the minute. It looked like I caught up with you in the summer. We played a bit of golf and you looked like a kid just on your gap year. You were just the way of the world off your shoulders. Obviously, coming from Gloucester, where the intensity is high, the expectations high, and just there's a lot of pressure. And I suppose I look back, I watch rugby now, there's not a second where I think I would like to be out there again.
no chance. So having had that once, and you've, I suppose this is kind of your second retiring twice, and I wonder, no, do you look back and think, I'm so glad that I don't have the pressure every week, because, you know, your main responsibility in the summer was walking the dog and playing golf. And you just looked like, it was good for you, I suppose, just that time with the family and yeah. change of perspective.
Oh, look, I mean, I would love to do it again. Unlike you, I went through that phase for a few years after I finished playing. I didn't miss it at all. And I can't remember when, but I actually do miss not being able to play. And having seen, because I've been involved, I've seen what, how these academy players start to come through, the system they come through. And I would love to try and come through it as a professional rugby player from, well, basically 16, 17. But you're right. I loved, when you're in it, when you're in the living, in that moment, when you're the pressure's there, you love, I loved every minute of being in Ulster as a player. I loved every minute of being in Ulster as a administrator. I loved my time in Gloucester. But when you come out of it, you almost take a deep breath and go, right. And I, you know, as you said, I think I played golf, not quite every day, but not far off it. And that was just a fantastic release. But it also means that when you get that release, it gives you a little bit of time to reflect. And having been out of the game, and at the time probably, even maybe when you and I first spoke, Trimby, on the golf course, I wasn't sure if I had fallen out of love with the game. Just because of the way it all finished in Gloucester and the way the impact that COVID had had and where the game was going. But I think being out of the game for a while, you suddenly realised, you know what, that this is the sport that I love. This is the sport that I've grown up with. This is the sport that I want to see my son, other children playing in the long term. And that's why I'm sitting here now. The easy thing would have been just to sit back and not, you know, enjoy a bit more golf and sit and watch the competition. But the there's something inside you that goes, you know what? I want to get back in there. I want to be, as we said earlier, part of that competitive edge in the weekend. So I've really, really enjoyed the break, but I'm also enjoying being back in. And you know, that's where longer term, I don't know where it's going to take.
Yeah, we've the potential of getting very philosophical here, and we're all going to start bursting into tears very soon.
Well, I know it's like there's a lot of positives to come from coaching and director of rugby. There can be some negatives as well, especially when one of your players sets up a fake Twitter account under your name and starts tweeting, criticizing current players. I don't think I've ever heard something so cheeky. And for anyone that doesn't know, it was Andrew Trimble who set up. Is this true? You know that this was Trimby, right?
Yeah. Well, it's...
Tell us.
He got off unbelievably lightly, by the way. I'd have fined him a huge amount more. Shane Logan at the time, who was CEO, actually was very soft on him. But you know what, Barry? It was a case of, we were trying to find out who it was. We had suspicion. And we were sitting down one day. And I went, Trimby, I actually think it's you. And he went, yes, it is.
You got me.
He didn't deny it. He didn't try and make it hard. He just conceded it almost straight away. So, yeah.
It's because it went on for so long that eventually I actually just wanted credit for it.
But, you know, at the time we all thought it was very funny, but there were two... Because there were two, I can't even remember now which ones they were. You probably remember every tweet word for word, Trimby, but there were two or three funny ones, and there were two or three that were probably a bit too close to the bone for some of you.
Yeah, I think I know the one you're referring to.
Are you going to share it? Is that not?
Share it privately afterwards.
Ah, oh, come on. Give us a taste of some of them anyway, at least.
I think we had signed Callum Black. And we knew that he was a mate of Tui's. And then I think I thought on you know, speaking on your behalf, I tweeted Tui and thanked him for putting in a good word because we got Callum so cheap. yeah. Cheap as chips, I think was the expression.
But even worse, you tried, I think at one stage you actually tweeted about yourself as well. Which, you know, almost to try and throw us off the scent.
It worked for a while.
Yeah.
I think I had a hand injury. I think I got an operation on my finger, and then I think I tweeted myself and said, "Don't worry about it. Sure, you can't catch your pass anyway."
Oh, like, genius!
Not a million miles from the truth.
So. Those are the sort of things, honestly, that at the time they probably annoy you. Mm. But in public, you got to pretend that it's not right. But in private, it's actually quite funny, and we all did it as a management team. We had a laugh a few nights about what was been tweeted, but at the same time, we were trying to find out desperately who it was.
I just remember Shane Logan. He articulated what you're saying there. Really, I was invited very formally to a Twitter investigation. I walked into this room, and the head of HR, and then Shane Logan there, the CEO at the time. And Shane goes, Trimby, this is actually very funny, but I'm going to have to fine you. Sorry. So just one of those ones you have to do the party line. Listen, we'll get back to rugby very quickly. What on earth happened to Ireland last weekend? Humph, are England just too good? Can you not attack against that style of defence, or what's going on?
I think it's probably a combination of a number of factors. One, I do think England are a fantastic team. They are so well organised. They're reminiscent of Saracens in that they know exactly what they're going to do, and they do it unbelievably well. Eddie's got a very clear philosophy on what he believes are the fundamentals of Test match rugby, and they stick to them. And even against us, against Georgia, you'd have thought they might have, despite the weather, tried to break away from that and play a little bit more rugby. Not at all. They stuck to what they're good at. Last week, look, Ireland are in a situation where, obviously, with Andy Farrell coming in, they want to try and change their game a little bit. As we talked about earlier, changing your game is not an easy solution, especially when you consider how successful that Irish team was playing under Joe and the very clear way that Joe had them set up and organised. So to answer your question in two ways, one, I do think England are an unbelievably good team. But secondly, I think Ireland are in a transition period, and it will take them some time to change how they want to play. And, you know, with the quality of players they have and the quality of coaching team they have, I have no doubt they'll get there.
And then with that in mind, then what would be a successful outcome, or what would you be happy with in terms of progression for your lads, your Georgian lads?
The biggest disappointment in the last two games is that we haven't scored a point. You know, not only have we not kicked a penalty, we've been zeroed, nilled both times. So for us this week, it's about going and getting our set piece right. Our set piece has to be good against Ireland. What we do want to be doing is doing what England did, making 226 tackles or whatever the number made, because England can do that. Georgia, with where they are at the minute, with the players, in terms of their development, in terms of their match fitness, that we'll run out of steam a long way before the final whistle. So we've got to be in the game with our set piece. We've got to hold on to the ball a little bit. We've got to be able to try and challenge Ireland's defence. And again, we talk about England's defence, but Ireland's defence is blooming good as well. It's very physical. A lot of choke tackles, which a lot of these players won't have experienced before. So we've got to make sure our carry height's good. Ireland's ability to contest at almost every breakdown right across the team will pose a major threat for us as well. So, look, we know how good Ireland are. As we said earlier, they're top two or three teams in the world. And so from Georgia's point of view, we want to go out and we want to try and show that our attacking game has been developed.
Yeah, okay. Well, listen, we wish you all the best. We'll not hold you back any longer, but good luck at the weekend. I certainly am going to be watching you during the anthems just to see how many Georgian words you've learned. But
I'm wearing a mask. I'm saying. Like, anyway, at the weekend, I know them all. I know them. Know every word.
Well, listen, good luck, Humph. Thanks a lot for coming on. Good to catch up with you.
Thank you so much. Cheers, man. Cheers. Thanks.
Cheers, Humph.
Bye-bye.
Hello, everyone. I just want to take this moment to thank you very much for supporting us on the Patreon. It really helps us to make wonderful audio and video podcasts for you all on the YouTube and on the podcast app. So go to patreon.com/potholesandpenguins and donate a fiver, and we'll keep making great podcasts for y'all. Sound lads, all the best.